Good evening and welcome to ABC 31 News tonight. I'm Scott Beadle. State Police Superintendent Mike Edmondson has less than two more weeks on job. He's held for 10 years under two governors. Tonight's big story, a native of Alexandria and a graduate of Menard High, Edmondson is retiring after a series of blows to his leadership, including a junket on taxpayer dollars made by senior staff without his knowledge. Brittany Weiss has the story.
It's not a resignation. I wasn't asked to resign.
A sudden retirement. The head of the Louisiana State Police announcing his decision to let go of the reins.
I believe this was the right time to do this.
The move comes as the department faces backlash for questionable spending.
I think this trip to San Diego is not a defining moment.
Concern grew after the agency paid thousands of dollars to send a group to a conference out west.
What we'll be defining about is how we deal with it.
The department is currently being audited. Whether it pushed the colonel to remove himself is a possibility he denies.
No, because that's something that's going to be addressed. And whether that takes another week, 2 weeks, a month, it's going to be addressed and we're going to move on.
Despite the controversy, Edmondson leaves behind a long history with state police.
Sure, it's a sad day to step down after that many years, because that's all I've known.
A steady hand during several high-profile events. Most recently, the shooting death of Alton Sterling, which led to several days of protests.
We're following these leads wherever they take us.
And ultimately, the killing of three Baton Rouge law enforcement agents. Governor Edwards remained tight-lipped when we tried to talk to him today.
I am late to a radio program, but I'm sure we released a statement this morning.
A statement where he applauded the colonel for his service and said he supports his decision.
Jury selection stretched into a fourth day in the murder trial of a deputy city marshal in Marksville. Derek Stafford is accused of killing a six-year-old child and wounding his father after a chase at night. Judge William Bennett is seeking a panel of 14, 12 jurors, and two substitutes. He's also holding off on a ruling on whether that trial needs to be moved to another parish. Alexandria police use surveillance cameras to arrest a man from the Otis community for allegedly breaking into a vehicle and stealing a wallet. 25-year-old Robert Jenkins is charged with burglary and unauthorized use. Police say the victim was parked near a business on North Mall Drive when that incident happened yesterday afternoon. Officers say they tracked the use of the credit card to another business on Old Boyce Road when the arrest was made. Another suspect traveling with Jenkins was charged with a misdemeanor. The joint investigation nets arrests of some 15 people charged with drug trafficking and using counterfeit bills. Rapids deputies collaborated with Allen Parish and other law enforcement to make those arrests. They say they found some $230,000 worth of meth, plus $25,000 worth of heroin. And that's in addition to the seizure of the counterfeit bills. The suspects are from Boyce, Colfax, Alexandria, Pollock, Pineville, Houston, Texas, and Connecticut. Two are arrested by Rapids deputies for theft of items from a storage shed. They're 45-year-old Henry Miles Jr. and 38-year-old Hardy Dwayne Dunn Jr., both of Boyce. Deputies say detectives were led to Miles when he reportedly tried to sell an item which had the victim's name on it. The break-in happened on Fredericksburg Road near Rapids Station late last month. The two are charged with burglary and Dunn with drug possession as well. A citizen of Angola who refused deportation is sentenced in Alexandria Federal Court to 6 months in prison. He's 46-year-old Faustino Ngay, who resisted ICE officials in November and again in December. The oldest teen in a group of four accused of beating a man to death last August in a motel on MacArthur Drive has pleaded guilty to reduced charges. 17-year-old Akili Blade Jr. admitted to conspiracy to commit robbery and manslaughter. He and three others who were 16 at the time of the crime had been charged with murder. Blade will be sentenced in May. Rapids deputies in the Glenmore area say they've arrested a man who consistently violated a protective order. He's 34-year-old Waylon Dwayne Dunnison of Hindston. Deputies also charged him with resisting arrest. They say he fled when they caught up with him at a disturbance in the Hindston convenience store. Rapids deputies have arrested two men on suspicion of stealing a gun from a local pawn shop. There are 35-year-old Charles DeMonte Hall and 57-year-old George Johnson Jr., both of Alexandria. Both are charged with theft and violation of a gun offense. An appellate court has invalidated a liquor election in the tiny town of Florine in Sabine Parish. By a narrow margin, the voters decided to discontinue liquor sales there, but the appeals court judges say that election is invalid. Some Alexandria City Councilmen say they are aware, though it has not been officially announced, that Daniel Williams is away from City Hall. Williams, the Director of Community Services, is reported by these council members to be off the staff pending an investigation. Meanwhile, City Councilman at Large Joe Fuller says he's asking for a Finance Committee hearing on the use of credit cards by city employees. Nobody is officially saying whether this is an issue connected to Williams' absence. Fuller says he has written the finance chairman, Harry Silver, and has not yet gotten a response. Williams serves at the pleasure of the mayor, and City Hall spokesmen are not commenting at this time. Get ready for temperatures to warm up again. Here's Chief Meteorologist Chris Summers with your weather now.
Hey, Scott. Yeah, definitely going to see some warmer temperatures as we head into the weekend. Today into the 60s, though, still below average for this time of year. Our high temperatures across our area were, again, low to mid-60s in most areas, but you can see a little bit warmer air down to our south. 67 the high in Lake Charles, 70 degrees Baton Rouge, but 61 degrees in Shreveport, 64 degrees the high today here in Alexandria. So it will be warmer for your St. Patrick's Day on your Friday. Should see temperatures at least in the low 70s, but a mixture of sun and clouds as we go through the day. Could see a few showers or maybe a thunderstorm move in for Saturday. A little on the isolated side, not expecting a big chance of rain, but temperatures still going to stay relatively warm. And as we get to Sunday, then could still see a few showers in the forecast, at least off and on for your Sunday afternoon. But temperatures should stay in the low to mid 70s here as we head into the last weekend of winter. So we'll talk more about that with your 7-day forecast coming up in just a few more minutes.
Thanks, Chris. Mayors from cities and towns affected by floods are in Alexandria on a learning mission. These six mayors are being given access to experts in order to help them find out how to keep this from happening again. They're from Campty and from Natchitoches Parish in our area, as well as points south and north. They'll be studying ways to make their communities resilient to these crises. Their studies include planning, urban design, and hazard mitigation. The event is sponsored by the LSU Coastal Sustainability Studio. The Alexandria Federal Magistrate is honored with an award from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. He's Judge Joseph Perez Montes, shown here. The judge is named the 2016 Southern Region Legal Support Person of the Year. Southern Region covers 14 states. He presides over misdemeanor offenses that happen on federal lands. The magistrate did not know he was going to receive this award. How do we celebrate St. Patty's Day in Louisiana? Well, with a crawfish boil, of course. So what's happening tomorrow in downtown Alexandria at the Holiday Inn and benefits the American Cancer Society.
We're going to have jumps for the kids. We're going to have crawfish for sale, beer for sale. Johnny Earthquake and the Moondogs are coming down to play from 6 to 8. So there's really going to be a lot going on. And it's all to benefit American Cancer Society. Crawfish for sale. So we'll do 3 pounds for $15, corn, potatoes, all the fixings. That's going to be there all from 5 to 8 is what we're going to do. And we've actually partnered up with the other businesses downtown to give this kind of a block party feel. I mean, this isn't just us doing this. So the Mirror Room is involved, Diamond Grill, Embers, you know, a lot of these other local businesses are going to be involved with this whole process.
Admission to the event is free with food and drink for purchase. The Exchange Club of Alexandria featured a presentation today on the Deep South Hog Rally, a regional rally for a Harley owners group that will be hosted in Alexandria this year.
The reason we come together is because we're a large group of motorcycle enthusiasts that share a common interest, and we like to get together and share our enthusiasm for motorcycles and the lifestyle of riding Harley-Davidsons.
The Harley Owners Group Regional Rally will be April 6th through the 8th. Japanese magnolias are beautiful spring flowering trees, and now is a good time to plant them. With a variety of flower colors and styles, they can be a striking sight in Louisiana landscapes. On this edition of Get It Growing, LSU Ag Center horticulturist Dan Gill explains where to plant your Japanese magnolia and how to care for it.
The Japanese or saucer magnolia is among my favorite of the spring flowering trees we grow in our Louisiana landscapes. You can see a lovely specimen of this tree behind me. Now, these trees are actually the result of hybridizing several different species of magnolias together. And that means that these Japanese magnolias show a great deal of diversity. This one has lovely dark purple flowers with these narrow petals. You can also find them with larger flowers that may be lavender or shades of pink. And there are also white ones that are available as well. And these all belong to that same group we call the Japanese magnolias. They bloom before the foliage emerges, and that gives the flowers a lot of distinction on the tree. Later on, some beautiful medium green foliage will emerge, and these trees will be lovely green through the summer season. We like to grow these small trees with multiple trunks. You can see this one has four trunks. 3 to 5 is our typical number of trunks that we grow these trees with. As the trees go taller over the years, they're not very fast growers, but as they grow taller over the years, it's good idea to remove these lower branches slowly over time to raise the canopy up to the height that you want it to be. Another pruning job you want to watch for are these little sprouts that come out from the base of the trunk. Prune those off promptly whenever you see them. Now locate these lovely little magnolias in a sunny, well-drained area of your landscape. They don't like wet, heavy soils. They will take a little bit of shade during the day. You can see there's a big oak behind this one, but the more sun, the more flowers. This is a great time to plant them. You'll find them in bloom at your area local nurseries now, and this is a wonderful time to add them to your landscape. These lovely Japanese magnolias. Forget it growing. I'm Dan Gill with the LSU Ag Center.
For more information on other lawn and garden topics, contact your parish's LSU Ag Center Extension Service Office or visit the LSU Ag Center website at www.lsuagcenter.com and click on the Lawn and Garden button. President Trump's travel ban 2.0 is blocked by federal judges, and it comes amidst more questions about wiretapping claims. That story is next. To the latest from Washington now, the president is pledging to keep fighting for his newly revised travel ban 2.0, even as more judges around the country rule to block it. And the president is still left answering questions about those tweets accusing the former administration of wiretapping a Trump Tower when he was a candidate. ABC's Maggie Rooley has the latest.
I do. Love Ireland.
President Trump's looking forward to St. Patrick's Day during the Irish Prime Minister's visit, but he's still having to look back, bringing up that initial executive order on immigration.
I think we ought to go back to the first one and go all the way.
After judges in Hawaii and Maryland are ruling to block his newly revised travel ban. Opponents say it still discriminates on the basis of nationality and religion. But President Trump calls the rulings judicial overreach, and the Justice Department says the ruling is flawed.
The danger is real, and the law is clear. And he will continue to exercise his constitutional authority and presidential responsibility to protect our nation.
The president's also left answering to those tweets he sent accusing former President Obama of wiretapping Trump Tower. Now on Fox News, he shares where he got this information.
I've been reading about things. I said, wait a minute, there's a lot of wiretapping being talked about. I've been seeing a lot of things.
The White House says the term wiretap is really a broader term for surveillance. But with no actual evidence of either, Senator Patrick Leahy tells CNN this source doesn't cut it.
This is the President of the United States. He has access to all the intelligence in this country. He knows it's not true.
And now pressure is building for FBI Director James Comey to come out with exactly what he knows.
Director Comey, have you seen any evidence that President Obama wiretapped Trump Tower?
The leading members of the Senate Intelligence Committee did have a chance to meet with Director Comey. They released a joint statement today saying that based on the information available to them, they see no evidence of any government surveillance at Trump Tower. Maggie Rooley, ABC News, New York.
Well, it's getting a little colder than usual out there.
Yeah, definitely seeing those temperatures below average once again today, but warmer days are ahead. Just going to take another day or two to get here, especially by the weekend. Should see high temperatures back into the 70s, maybe even close to 80 by early next week. 64 degrees the high today. That's a little bit below average of 71. And looks like we'll see those cooler temperatures get out of here just in time for the first day of spring, which is Monday. So we'll talk more about that when we come back. And welcome back. Welcome back, everyone. Temperatures into the 60s here across here. I got choked up over the cold temperatures, I guess. Temperatures in the 60s here late this afternoon. As we saw here in parts of Louisiana, temperatures are below average once again. We're seeing those temperatures that should be in the 70s, basically staying in the 60s. But some warmer days are back in the forecast. Your St. Patrick's Day Friday should get closer to average, low 70s expected, and then into the mid to upper 70s, maybe low 80s. By the time we get to the upcoming weekend. So something to look forward to, that's for sure. Here's your highs from today, 65 degrees in Natchitoches, 67 degrees Lake Charles, a little bit warmer to our south and east, Baton Rouge at 70 late this afternoon, 63 degrees in Monroe, 61 Shreveport, and we saw a high today of 64 here in Alexandria. Outside right now, we still have cloudy skies, 63 degrees currently, and our dew point's at 51 degrees. It feels like 63 as well as our south winds continue at about 14 to 15 miles per hour, and our pressure is holding pretty steady. Now for your Friday, your St. Patrick's Day, again, temperature is going to warm up nicely. Should get back into the mid to upper 70s by the time we get to Friday afternoon. That's going to put temperatures back above average once again, so we'll enjoy a nice Friday, that's for sure. And seeing just a few clouds out there from time to time, otherwise mostly sunny skies in our forecast. So much warmer weather back in the area to end the work week. Again, it's just a mix of sun and clouds with temperatures being warmer. Could see a few showers or thunderstorms around the area for your Saturday. Wouldn't be surprised to see just a few of those showers left over maybe early Sunday morning. Otherwise, they clear out Sunday afternoon. And it looks like temperatures by early next week get back into the 80s. Yeah, first day of spring is on Monday. And by then, looks like high temperatures should be in the low to mid 80s in most areas of central Louisiana. Now, your surface map as we head into your Friday. Again, your St. Patrick's Day, not showing too much going on around our area. We are going to see a little bit warmer weather get back into our region. That's good news here in Louisiana. A little bit of rain to our north, along with some cooler temperatures as well, but most of that rain should stay up there for much of Friday. But as it starts to make its move overnight Friday into early Saturday, we may see a little bit of rain activity back in the forecast this weekend. Right now, it looks like pretty isolated chances, maybe 20 to 30% chance of a shower or thunderstorm as we get to our weekend. But for tonight, 54 degrees, not quite as cold as we've been seeing the last couple of nights. Southeast winds at about 5 to 10 miles per hour for our Friday. Again, St. Patrick's Day, 77 degrees. Our high temperature will be a little bit warmer, that's for sure, with a mixture of sun and clouds, south winds continuing at 5 to 10 miles per hour. 7-day forecast, there's a chance of a few showers or thunderstorms on our Saturday. High temperature very close to 80. We'll go 79 Saturday afternoon, 81 for your Sunday. Partly sunny skies. Again, maybe a shower out there once again. Now, first day of spring is on Monday with highs in the low 80s. We'll go for 83 by Monday afternoon. And keeping the nice warm weather in the forecast next week. May see another chance for a few showers or thunderstorms on Tuesday with those high temperatures in the low 80s. Then maybe back to the upper 70s for the middle part of next week. But overall, next 7 days looking much better than we've been seeing as spring officially arrives early next week. Scott?
Thanks, Chris. Coming up, NSU baseball coach Bobby Barbier talks about the upcoming series against Oklahoma State. Plus, Team USA is off to one of their best starts ever in the World Baseball Classic.
The NSU softball team continued their dominance over Louisiana Tech this week with a 5-3 win over the Lady Texters. Now NSU has now won 7 of the last 8 between the two teams, and it meant even more this time around because it snapped a 7-game losing streak.
It means a lot to beat Louisiana Tech. We play them often. They're near us, and they're a very good and a respectable school to play, and it's it's a great competition to prepare us for this weekend for Abilene Christian.
Now, unlike the softball team, the Demon baseball team will be heading on the road this weekend. NSU will be starting a 7-game road trip against 23rd-ranked Oklahoma State, the final non-conference series for NSU. It's against a pretty big 12 powerhouse team that should give the Demons a new kind of challenge.
They're really good. Coach Holliday does a great job over there. I think made it to Omaha last year. So they've got a great team. It'll be neat. Another neat experience for our guys to go out and play somewhere. I've never been to that park personally, so it'll be neat for me to get out and see that park and for our guys to get out and play somewhere they're not used to playing.
Team USA has never really had success in the World Baseball Classic. They've never medaled, and their best finish was fourth place back in 2009. So with a new year, a new classic, they're hoping for something a little bit different. This year, second round action against Venezuela. They were looking to improve to 3-1. Pick this one up in the bottom of the third. USA down one, but they've got the bases loaded. Orioles' Adam Jones, though, grounds into the inning ending 4-6-3 double play to end the threat. But guess what? He would make up for it in the eighth. USA down one. Well, not anymore. Jones, solo shot to left. This game is tied up. Then a few batters later, Royals' Eric Hosmer getting all of that baseball. Two-run shot to right gives Team USA the lead. They hold it as they improve to 3-1 on the year. The U.S. women's hockey team, one of the most successful programs in the U.S. national ranks, and they're planning a potential boycott. A number of players on the team are threatening to pull out of the upcoming World Championships over wages and lack of support from USA Hockey. In a statement released this week, the players are asking for fair wages along with equitable support for youth team development, travel expenses, marketing, and publicity. The U.S. women's team has won gold in 6 of the last 8 World Championships and have medaled in every Olympics since women's hockey became an Olympic sport in 1998. The U.S. hockey responded to each player to confirm if they intended to play. They gave them a deadline of tonight to answer. Team USA responded by saying, nah, we're not going to listen to your deadline. The March Madness tournament tipped off today. Plenty of first-round games already wrapped up, and the Indiana Hoosiers, well, they made news for something they did off the court. After 9 years with the team, head coach Tom Crean has been fired. Crean won a pair of Big Ten titles and made 4 NCAA appearances in his tenure, but failed to make the dance after a disappointing season. And they say fortune favors the bold, or is it the foolish, Scott? Either way, pro golfer Cody Gribble very fortunate today when he boldly stepped up and tapped a gator on the tail along the water on hole number 6 here at the Arnold Palmer Invitational. Ooh, as you can see, the surprised gator, instead of turning around to chomp off Gribble's hand, just scurries into the water. Gribble just continues walking up the fairway like it's nothing. I don't think I would have done that. I think I would have just moseyed along.
Kept on going.
Yeah, thankfully for him, the gator just, I think, was more surprised that someone reached out and touched him.
Yeah, they get a little startled. And
I think a little bit.
They can move.
Yeah, pretty fast. So luckily it went straight forward into the water and not turn around and attack the golfer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thanks, Nick. Yeah. We're back right after this. Earlier this week, mom made the best of those snow days. In Philadelphia, not only did Serenity Chung get to play in the snow, well, her playmate was a T-Rex, something most kids can only dream about. Serenity's mom, Simi, donned this T-Rex costume to make the most of that snow day. It appears that Chung maybe had a little bit of a hard time throwing some snowballs with tiny T-Rex arms, but that did not stop her from having a great morning, as you can hear from a few of Serenity's giggles there. The snowball fight was followed up by a quick game of tag as well.
So I wonder if they had the costume just sitting there, or you actually go out and rent that costume for the snow day. I wonder.
That is an excellent question. Interesting. But either way, it's a good outcome.
I like
questions we need answered right there.
Have a great night, and thanks for watching.